Join me as we share the words of the psalmist found in Psalm 138. He writes, "We gather to give thanks to you, O Lord, with all our hearts. We will sing your praise before all creation and rejoice in your steadfast love. You have created us, O Lord, and made us for yourself. In you, we become everything you have made us to be." Join me in prayer. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. And with the psalmist, we stand in awe and humility as we come to you, Father, in your throne of grace. For in these graduates, you have given us a precious gift. You've instilled in them a limitless curiosity about your world, your people. This curiosity, Lord, this thirst for truth has led each one of them here in this place tonight. And we are so grateful for the privileged years of friendship, of diligence, and even struggle. And so this evening we rejoice in their achievements and celebrate your presence in their lives through the love and support of parents, siblings, family, friends, mentors, teachers, coaches, and others. We are grateful for all who have made this moment possible in each one's life. We ask, O Lord, that you would support and strengthen these graduates as they journey into the unknown, as they journey into these unprecedented times. May they find their strength in your imminence and comfort in knowing you have called them and prepared them for such a time. As we prepare to leave here and these graduates walking a new path, we ask, O gracious Lord, that you would continue to fill them with a deep and abiding knowledge of your love for them. And we ask that by your Spirit they will be nourished and renewed by the hope of the gospel of Christ, the good news that God is good, that Christ is Lord, and that the powers of evil have been defeated. And so may you and you alone be glorified in this place tonight. For these graduates, we give you praise and honor. Amen.
mystery, He the perfect Son of Man. In His living, in His suffering, never trace nor stain of sin. See the true and better Adam come to save the hell-bound man. Christ the great and sure fulfillment of the law, in Him we stand. The Lord upon the tree, in the stead of ruined sinners, hangs the Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption, see the Father's plan unfold, bringing many sons to glory, grace unmeasured.
Good evening. On behalf of the faculty, the staff, and the board of directors of Conway Christian School, it is my privilege to welcome you to our school's graduation ceremony. We are so grateful to have our ceremony this evening here at the Rock Sanctuary to glorify God's gift of a Christian education for these graduates and to celebrate the culmination of all their hard work throughout their high school years. Tonight, we are here to thank God and ask His blessings for the class of 2022 as we honor them for this tremendous achievement. As we celebrate with these seniors, I want to respectfully request that we keep this ceremony reverent by applauding our graduates at the end of the ceremony and holding our cheers and whistles until then. To the parents and families of our senior class, we want to thank you for the work, prayers, and sacrifices you have made in order for your children to reach this important milestone in their lives. If you are a parent or grandparent of tonight's graduates, would you please stand? Let's give them a round of applause. Thank you so much for your support in helping these students achieve their goal tonight. To our seniors, I want each of you to know that I've enjoyed teaching you this year in British Lit and listening to your discussions about your plans for your future. It has been a privilege to pray with you about your decisions and goals each day. I also enjoyed being a part of your senior trip to Texas. I will forever have the vision of those of you that wore your Bucky onesies, your laughter, and your joy in being together. And now we have come to the end of your time in high school. So I want to encourage you to remember the life lessons you were taught and the friendships you have made. And I hope that each of you will continue to remain strong in your faith and to study God's word daily. I hope you know that I am beyond proud of you for completing your senior year and excited for you and your future plans. You're an amazing group of young people. And my prayer for you as you leave Conway Christian School is that you trust in the Lord to direct your path and that you continue to grow in your faith. Finally, I hope that you will reflect on these words from Proverbs 19, 20, 21. Listen to advice, accept discipline, and in the end you will be counted among the wise. Seniors, be disciplined and wise in all you do, and look to the Lord to direct your path. Congratulations to you, the class of 2022. Remember, you have many here tonight who love you and who will continue to pray for you. May God bless you.
Good evening, friends, family, Conway Christian School board members, teachers, administration, and alumni. My name is Josiah Crawford, and it is my honor as the salutatorian of the class of 2022 to welcome you to the 25th commencement ceremony of Conway Christian School. I would like to welcome our distinguished speaker for tonight's ceremony, Ms. Ellen Weaver, president of Palmetto Promise. To the Rock, thank you for allowing us to use your facility. To my classmates, it is my privilege to congratulate you for your running your race and pushing through the last 13 years of countless assignments, tests, and last-minute projects. We have grown up together and witnessed each other's prime and not-so-prime moments, whether in the classroom or on the athletic field or in the fast-paced instance of life. The friendship and camaraderie have been a great gift from God. To the teachers and administration of our great school, I thank you for investing into our lives. Your sacrifice, gracious love have not gone unnoticed. The seeds of faithfulness, instruction, and correction will serve us well as we transition into adulthood and begin to chart our own journey. You will forever hold a special place in our hearts. To our parents, what can I say? It's almost over. For 18 years, you have reared us with compassion, love, and selfless desire for our good and well-being. You have prayed over us, knowing that the Lord hears the cries of the righteous, that He is faithful. You have sacrificed for our education and given us every opportunity to reach love you and stand as grateful recipients of God's greatest guardians. To the class of 2022, in my last public remarks, let me issue this challenge. Let us not waste what we have gained from our educational experiences at Conway Christian School. Graduation is a time of irony, excitement combined with fear, beginnings obscured with endings, plans stifled with uncertainty, but it's only the start of a roller coaster called life. So how might we find success beyond high school? As we search the scriptures, we find that as King David was about to die, he gave his son Solomon the following advice: do whatever the Lord your God commands and follow his teachings. Obey everything written in the law of Moses. Then you will be a success no matter what you do or where you go. David didn't tell his son to build up his kingdom with great armies or gather wealth from other lands or defeat his enemies in battle. Instead, his formula for success was to follow God and obey him. When Solomon became king, he didn't ask the Lord for wealth and power, but for wisdom and discernment in order to lead God's people. God was no doubt pleased by this request and granted it, giving Solomon a wise and understanding heart more than any man had ever had before. He also gave Solomon things that he didn't ask for, riches, honor among men. Solomon took his father's advice to heart, at least for most of his reign, and reflected on it in his writings and proverbs. My son, do not forget my teachings, but let your heart keep my commandments. For length of days and years of life and peace they will add to you. Let not steadfast love and faithfulness forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart, so you will find favor and good success in the sight of God and man. By God's grace, graduates, may we have Solomon's pursue a life and calling that is pleasing unto the Lord. As Christ followers, we may seek the fruit of the Spirit of God who resides in our hearts: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. In doing so, we gain unhindered amounts of wisdom and peace that passes all understanding. For fellow graduates, thank you for being part of that journey. May we find our future success is not in worldly riches, but in the words of the Apostle Peter: be all the more diligent to conform your calling and election, for if you practice these qualities, you would never fail. For in this way, there will be richly provided for you an entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Parents, teachers, and the administration, again, I want to thank you for making tonight possible. And to my classmates, may God continue to bless each of you richly as you take your next steps of obedience and faithfulness. To him be all the glory.
This time, it's my pleasure to introduce our guest speaker tonight, Ms. Ellen Weaver. Prior to serving as the founding president and CEO of Palmetto Promise Institute, Greenville native Ellen Weaver worked in a wide variety of roles in U.S. Senator Jim DeMint's Washington and South Carolina offices. Her final assignment as state director included management of staff, communications, and outreach strategy. Her work portfolio also includes development, speech writing, coalition building, and authorship of editorials published nationally and across the opinion pages of South Carolina. Ms. Weaver currently serves on the South Carolina Education Oversight Committee, where she is the immediate past chair and the first woman to ever hold that position. She is a deacon, chorister, and music leader for Friendship Club, a ministry to young people with special needs at the First Presbyterian Church of Columbia. She is also the proud aunt of an exceptional young nephew and a devoted dog mom, and loves to garden and travel abroad. She graduated from Bob Jones University in 2001, where she earned a BA in political science, summa cum laude, with a minor in music. She is currently earning her master's from Bob Jones University in educational leadership. Join me in welcoming Ms. Weaver tonight.
Well, Mrs. Smith, thank you for the honor of joining you and the graduates and their families tonight. It's a joy and honor to be with you, the 2022 graduating class of Conway Christian School, and your families as you celebrate this special occasion. Although my own high school graduation was 25 years ago, and I heard someone reference that your first graduating class, I guess, would have been in 1997, so that is when I was graduating from high school. It feels like yesterday, and watching you all watch that video together brought back so many wonderful memories of when I graduated from high school and the excitement that my friends and I felt. Believe it or not, you all have the distinct hazard of being the first commencement address that I have ever delivered, and so by God's grace, we'll hopefully all come through this on the other side together. But when Mrs. Anderson so graciously invited me to speak with you all, she specifically asked that I share with you a few thoughts about my own life journey. I hesitated at first because this day is first and foremost about your accomplishments, not about me. But I pray that in sharing a few of the lessons that I have learned along the way in my life, that they will be helpful to you as you embark on this potential-filled new chapter of your lives. And like the men who came to the disciples in John 12 and said, "Show us Jesus," it's my prayer that in sharing a very short version of God's work in my own life, that you'll see Jesus at work in those details. He alone is worthy of all of the praise. So I'd like to frame our thoughts and time together by reading to you a passage that has been very instrumental in my own life, Philippians 2, 1 through 11. "If there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count each other more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only on his own interests, but also on the interest of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not think it robbery to be equal with God and equality with God a thing to be grasped. But he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant and being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him a name above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father." We are entering a world starved with meaning. Where do you find your identity? You're now a graduate. Are you a son? Are you a daughter? Are you an athlete? Are you an academic? Are you someone who is going on to college? Are you someone who is going on to career? Will you be a future husband or wife? Whether we all know it or not, we have something that gives our life purpose, a root identity out of which the rest of our life and the meaning of that life flows. The quest for identity and meaning is really a defining narrative in our culture. I've seen this a lot in the 20 years that I have spent working in politics and public policy, where we see this in very stark terms. We divide ourselves along races or along classes, lines of class, race, gender, sexuality, political party, rural versus urban, rich versus poor. Everyone retreats to their respective tribe, and anyone who is different is viewed suspiciously or, worse yet, with contempt. But it's not just an out there in the world problem. Even good gifts that God gives us can become idols if they are not the primary source, or if they become the primary source of our identity, instead of us finding our value and worth in our union with Jesus. How radical, then, is Jesus's humility in Philippians 2? Through his work as the suffering servant, he has destroyed those dividing walls of hostility and empowered us to break through our prideful identity barriers as we reflect his love in the world. My life testimony is a story of the slow process of God wooing me away from an identity full of prideful self-sufficiency and turning my gaze to Jesus, the face of his dear son. I'm always amazed to look back in my life and see what I call the chain of providence. And I believe that in the coming years, you will look back on your lives and see that same chain, how he directs every step of the way, no matter how small the task or the event may seem, to bring you to the place of his divine appointment. I am confident that he is going to do the same thing for you as he has done in my life. So I was born in Greenville to a believing family, raised in a home where I learned the scripture. There wasn't a day that went by that I wasn't exposed to a Bible verse, whether through my Christian school or homeschool or church or Awana Club. And my parents really put a big emphasis on us hiding the word in our hearts, something that I know has been an emphasis in your education here. I was by all accounts a good kid. I kept all the rules. I knew all the answers by heart, but unfortunately, it was a head knowledge and not a heart knowledge. I found my identity and my self-worth in excelling, in trying to be the very best that I could be at everything I did, whether that was school, music, youth group, wherever it was, I could be found striving and trying to achieve. And so through this performance-driven identity, I struggled constantly with uncertainty about my salvation. I made multiple professions of faith, each time praying, "Lord, if I didn't mean it last time, I really mean it now." And I'm here to tell you, it was exhausting. Instead of being controlled by love, performance anxiety set in. Am I good enough? Can I do just a little bit better? Try just a little bit harder? And along with that came a stifling fear of failure. fear to be vulnerable or to show emotion or ask for help, a belief that I had to do this all by myself. So following graduation from Bob Jones University with a political science degree, I moved to Washington, D.C., where I would spend 7 of the next 12 years working hard for Senator Jim DeMint and rising through the ranks on Capitol Hill. Let me tell you, Washington is a heady place. It's a big pond, if you will. It is a city made for type AAA-plus personalities. So I fit right into the hustle and bustle and the performance mindset, and I loved every single minute. Unfortunately, during this time, I drifted away from church. I never doubted that God was real or that the Bible was true, but I certainly wasn't growing in my faith. But it says in Proverbs 16:5-6, "Everyone who is arrogant in heart is an abomination to the Lord. Be assured he will not go unpunished. By steadfast love and faithfulness, iniquity is atoned for, and by the fear of the Lord, one turns away from evil." And I'm so thankful to stand before you today and share with you that God's hesed, which is the Hebrew word for steadfast love, we've already heard that love referred to several times by our other speakers, his love never let me go. The word that had been poured into my heart as a child was quietly doing its work, discerning the thoughts and intents of my heart, as it says in Hebrews 4:12. So in 2010, job opportunity brought me back to South Carolina. I ended up in Columbia and was wonderful to be there. I found an incredible church that I still attend to this day. And through the next several years, my faith was renewed by the teaching of God's word. I got involved in many church ministries, and through those acts of service, I could feel my heart expanding. But in late 2012, crisis hit. It wasn't a death or the loss of a family member. It was rather a crisis of identity. Remember how I told you we all have an identity and I found mine in performance? Well, it's often hard for us to know how deep our twisted pride runs. And when my boss, Senator DeMint, retired unexpectedly from the U.S. Senate in December of that year, I was adrift and traumatized. Who was I if not Jim DeMint's state director? What was my relevance? My identity idol had been exposed. It hit me like a ton of bricks. I was still depending on myself and what I could do and not on what Jesus had already done. Throughout that next year, I hurt. I was genuinely mourning a deep loss along with the smashing of my dearest idols of achievement and control. But through that loss and loneliness and many tearful moments, God was continuing to expand my heart and deepen my ability to empathize with the struggles of others, to make me more patient, to make me more kind, and to turn my vision away from me and towards him and his love that he was calling me to experience and then to extend to others. Indeed, to bring me face to face with the reality that I don't have it all under control, that I don't have to have all the answers, and I most certainly am not God of myself or anyone else. In short, he humbled me. So I'd like to pretend that from that day forward, everything was fixed and that I don't have to let knowledge puff me up anymore and that I always follow the law of love to build others up. But you all know better than that. We all have daily struggles, and mine is with self-sufficiency. New crises have come and gone, and sometimes it's still hard for me to let go of control and ask for help. I still want to prove my competence, my credentials, and my expertise. But through all the muck and mire of my pride, he is still teaching me to take new risks in new ways, whether it's running for public office or in the daily journeys of faithfulness that requires each of us to simply put one foot in front of the other. Somebody once told me, just doing the next thing is what he requires. And the wonderful secret that I have learned and am learning is that by being humbled, I have received hope and rest, the shalom, the wholeness that he promises to those he loves. And that's my message to you. Secure in his love, we know that he is everything we need. We can do all things through him because he gives us strength. His strength and glory will shine most brightly in our weaknesses. His plans for us are not for evil, but to give us hope in a future. That if we seek him, we will find him when we seek him with all our heart. And that he will complete the work that he has begun in our life until the day he brings us home to be with him forever. You are venturing out into a world of great upheaval. Technology has fundamentally reordered things. Institutions that have sustained culture and life for decades are in decline. We have epidemic rates of loneliness and depression, especially among young people. Fear abounds. And yet, in this yawning uncertainty shines a beacon of opportunity. Opportunity for you to be a beacon of hope. Does it seem like an overwhelming task, maybe even impossible? Well, take heart. Moses didn't believe that he could do the job, and yet he led God's people for over 40 years. King David was the least of his brothers, yet became Israel's greatest king. A barren old lady named Elizabeth became the mother of the greatest prophet that ever lived, the man who prepared the way for Christ's incarnation. Nehemiah faced constant harassment and opposition, and yet he kept his head down and faithfully rebuilt the walls of Jerusalem. You see, when God calls you, he equips you. And I think the call of God for your generation is to be builders, to rebuild the institutions of faith and society that the enemy has sought to destroy. My challenge to you today is to follow the example of the people who in Nehemiah 2:18 came together and said, "Let us rise up and build," and then they strengthened their hands for the good work. Your education here at Conway Christian School has played a significant role in that strengthening. Your teachers have poured God's love as well as academic knowledge into you. Whatever your next step, continue that spiritual and educational journey. Be a lifelong learner. The next few years are going to be so exciting and involve big decisions that will shape your life journey in profound ways. But even as you face challenges, which you surely will, remember where your hope lies. God loves you. He created you for a purpose. Rest in that love and purpose and share it with others. I'd like to close by sharing with you a passage written by Oz Guinness, one of the greatest Christian apologists of our time. A wise friend gave me his book, Entrepreneurs of Life, when I was facing that big change in my career that I told you about. It impacted me deeply, and I pray that it might be an encouragement to you. Mr. Guinness says, We as human beings rise to the call of our Creator. We become sub-creators, entering into our own creativity, artistry, and entrepreneurship as made in His image, thus adding to the rich fruitfulness of the universe. Answering the call of our Creator is therefore the ultimate why for living, the highest source of purpose in human existence, because it literally transforms us into entrepreneurs of life. The entrepreneur is the person who assumes the responsibility for a creative task, not as an assigned role or as a routine function or even as an inherited duty, but as a venture of faith, including risk and danger, in order to bring into the world something new and profitable to humankind. Called in this sense and answering such a call by rising to it in faith, entrepreneurs of life use their talents and resources to be fruitful and bring added value into the world, quite literally making the invisible visible, the future present, the ideal real, the impossible an achievement, the desired an experience, the status quo dynamic, and the dream a fulfillment. So my charge to you today is to go forward without fear. Listen for and answer God's call. Find your identity in Jesus. Become what He created you to be before the world began. And in so doing, you will spread the light and the love of the gospel to a desperate and dying world. This is your mission. Rely on His leading and in His power. Become entrepreneurs of life. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Members of the board, Ms. Smith, faculty and staff, family, friends, and fellow classmates, thank you for being here as we cross over into the next steps of our lives. We appreciate all of the sacrifices, decisions, and guidance you have made and given to us over the years. For me to stand up here and give this speech is surreal. To look out and see all of you, my classmates, in the audience about to graduate with me is crazy to even think about. Momentarily, we will walk across the stage as Mr. Hurley calls our names, shake the hand of Mr. Crawford as he hands us our diplomas, and walk back to our seats as class of 2022 graduates. Our years at CCS have shaped us and molded us into the people we are today. They have taught us discipline, determination, and good sportsmanship through sports, good values and Christian morals, and respect for authority. Discipline and respect will aid us in our careers. Determination and good sportsmanship will support us through college and continuing our studies. And good values and Christian morals will sustain us in our everyday walk with Christ. We should forever be grateful for the staff at Conway Christian School for their continuous support and lessons they have taught us. As I was preparing for this speech, I couldn't help but reminisce on some of the memories we made. Getting food from the lunchroom, sorry, Mama D, we love you. Manhunt at night on retreats and laughing incredibly hard at the dance that Hannah put on for the wrong Laura. The Washington, D.C. trip, staying up way too late playing spoons with Miss Sams while the guys played cards in their room. Our senior trip to San Antonio and some of us playing Monopoly until 6 a.m. And I can't forget about the fond memory that Raina, Victoria, Laura, and I have of Miss Smith coming into our room to wake us up after we slept through our alarm. We had about 5 minutes to get ready and most definitely got an earful. In her words, we were the first and last to ever do that on a senior trip. So I guess you could say we made senior trip history. We also can't forget about the stress Miss Smith's quizzes put each of us under and the crunch time before each of them getting in last minute studying. Finally, I think back to the Langston revival during our eighth grade year and us worshiping in Miss Ammon's room. The classroom still holds great memories for all of us who were here at the time. Roald Dahl once wrote, "A little nonsense now and then is cherished by the wisest men." And I believe this quote couldn't fit better for our class. All the lack of sense and crazy things we did made the best memories for us to look back on. I think about all of the trials we have faced as a class, and even though we didn't see eye to eye some of the time, we are still family. Through the difficulties all 14 of us have made those memories with the people whose friendships we hope last a lifetime. When we receive our diplomas that symbolize all of our hard work and accomplishments throughout high school, I hope and pray that we will all remember these two verses, Proverbs 3:5-6, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding, and all your ways submit to him." And Jeremiah 29:11, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future." God's will for our lives is far greater than any plan we could have right now at this moment. So, as we graduate and complete one of the most important milestones in our lives, my prayer is that we all put our faith in Christ to lead us down the path for his glory. Victoria, your ability to go with the flow while still being very aware of the things happening around you is a great quality to take through life. I hope that as you continue your studies at USC, you stay focused and persevere through it all. You've said many times that you want to be a housewife, and I have no doubt in my mind that you'll be great at that. Mekius, your rambunctious personality and loud mouth can be obnoxious at times, but you make sure no one forgets you are in the room, and that's what makes you so special. I am sure you will do great things following your time at CCS. Hannah, you are crazy and spastic, but that's what makes you you. You wouldn't be Hannah without your random movements or facial expressions that make class interesting. You will be a great nurse. Lance, your laugh is what makes everyone else laugh. If no one else found whatever was said or done funny, but you did, your laugh was so contagious no matter what. Your wisdom in politics and quickness for objections that I know all too well will make you such an effective and strong lawyer one day. Raina, your personality and humor never fails to make me laugh or cheer me up when I need it, and your willingness to always give always amazes me. I won't go too much into detail because I'll start crying, but thank you for being my best friend. I know your generosity and personality will take you far into whatever career path you decide to go down. Christian, your kindness towards others never fails to amaze me. Take that with you everywhere in life and continue doing what you're passionate about. You will do amazing things. DeAndre, your perseverance and determination earned you a full ride to Newberry, and I couldn't be prouder. As you go through life, carry those attributes with you and you will go so far. Never stop dreaming. Laura, your random burst of energy and the aura you display brightens everyone's day. As you pursue a career in speech pathology, your connection with others will aid you well, and I'm sure that you will be very successful in life. Emily, you are the mom of us all. You brought us donuts and kept us in line. When walking through life, that characteristic of making sure things are in order and people are provided for will serve you and others well. I have no doubt in my mind that you will become very distinguished. Cortland, the resilience you possess and the ability to stick up for yourself are beneficial for the trials this cruel, hard world contains. Never lose those qualities, and I'm confident that whatever you decide to do, you will become prosperous. Caroline, your gentleness and self-control is astonishing. Your passion for music is outstanding, and Coker should be glad to have you there. We always say that you'll be on Broadway, and if that is your dream, then I'm certain we'll see you there one day. Josiah, you are one of the smartest people I know and also the hardest to keep up with. Your knowledge puts up great competition, will take you so far, and be very advantageous as you continue your studies and pursue a career in dentistry. I am very happy for you and the accomplishment you have made. You will do great things as well. And last but not least, we all know him as Honeybun. Landon, your loyalty and friendship to others is so valuable, and your work ethic will serve you well as a heavy machine operator. Thank you for being the protective, supportive older brother I never had. Each and every single one of you has a gift that will aid you as you go through life. Take up those gifts and qualities that God has given you boldly and set yourselves apart. Have confidence in yourselves, love others, be determined and a hard worker, and be passionate. But there's one more characteristic that I want to leave with my fellow classmates and everyone else, and that is to be bold in your faith for Christ and use all of your gifts for good, because at the end of the day, that is who we are put on this earth to glorify. Never lose sight of that. We have made an impact individually and as a class on Conway Christian School. I know we will be remembered no matter what, especially as the foodies, the class who made everyone laugh, but also the class who was the biggest pain to all of our teachers, even though they all love us. And we know they love us because they put up with us and never left. Thank you to my fellow graduates for all the memories we have made together and the impact you all have had on my life personally. I am so excited to see where this life takes us. Congratulations, class of 2022. We have officially made it through high school.
Good evening, class. I am glad to be with you one last time before you are officially graduates and you don't have to call me Mr. Hurley anymore. And I am thankful to be able to be a part of this evening with you. And I will keep my remarks short. And to be honest with you, my remarks are not even my own. I want to share with you something that the Lord laid on my heart. With this being the class of 2022, I wanted to share with you 22 I ams of Christ for you to take with you. And if you will look beneath your chair, you will find a copy of what I am about to read if you want to take it and read along with me. I am reading, I'm not going to mention every verse, but I am going to at least share the truth of each verse. These are the 22 I ams that I want to share with you this evening before you come forward for your diplomas. I am your Savior, for you, for whom you labor and suffer reproach, because you trusted me, the Savior of all men, and those who believe in me. I am your Redeemer, who lives forever, who stood upon the earth and shall come again. I am your bread of life, in order that you may come to me and never hunger, that you may believe upon me and never thirst again. I am your Creator, for you have known and heard me through my word, the Creator of the ends of the earth, who never sleeps nor grows weary. I am your Deliverer, the only begotten Son whom the Father has given, in order that you may not perish, but have eternal life. I am your head, and you are my body. I am the one who is sanctifying you for eternity now as the temple of God. I am your Alpha and Omega. I am your beginning and your end. I am he who was, who is, and who is to come. I am your advocate, who has been made known to you in order that when you sin, you may have one before the Father, I, the righteous one. I am your mediator, who redeems your transgressions that you might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. I am your judge, who has commanded you to speak and live the truth before all men, for I will bring judgment upon all the living and the dead. I am your chief cornerstone, the foundation and hope upon which all the realities of truth and salvation rest. I am the author and perfecter of your faith, who endured the cross for you and is seated at the right hand of the Father, that you may look upon me and not lose heart. I am he who takes away your sin, the Lamb of God, who for your sake has pleased the wrath of God to come, that you may stand on the day of the Lord. I am your good shepherd, who has laid down his life, who wards off the wolves, and who is the gate of eternal life, that you may enter into my rest. I am your living word. He who speaks, and it is so, who has declared all things subject to my authority, and the word of life that you may hear and be saved. I am your rock, whose work and judgments are perfect, one without iniquity and perfectly just. I am your bridegroom, who will present you to myself without spot or blemish or any such thing. I rejoice over you, and by me you are fulfilled. I am your victor, who prevails over sin, hell, death, and the grave, who is worthy to receive all things and inherit all that the Father has given to me. I am your prize, who is the substance of your faith that will one day be sight, the image of the invisible God. I am your way, your truth, and your life. You have never been your own. However, I have made you my own because I have called you, drawn you, and sealed you in my spirit. I am your prophet, your priest, and your king, your Christ and anointed one who has fulfilled the law, purchased the gospel, and reigns with a name above every other name. And finally, I am who I am, that you may know these things and have peace. For in this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. With all the love with which I have loved you, the great I am, the Lord Jesus Christ. At this time, I will ask the seniors to please rise and come to the side as we call your name across as you come to get your diplomas. Landon Bray Allen. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Philippians 4, verse 4. Josiah Christopher Crawford. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love, wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in our sins, hath quickened us together in Christ. By grace you are saved, and hath raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places, in Christ Jesus. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 6. Caroline Grace Dill. If there therefore be any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels of mercy, fulfill ye my joy that ye may be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind, letting nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each other esteem one another better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. Cortland Elena Hardwick. There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man, but God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that which you are able, but will with temptation also take away and make a way for escape, that ye may be able to bear it. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. Laura Elizabeth Hewitt. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall keep her, and that right early. Psalm 46, verse 5. Emily Renee Lucius. My brethren, count it all joy when ye fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. DeAndre Hunter only. And let us not be weary in doing well, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Galatians 6, verse 9. Madison Jean Pegram. But I trusted in thee, O Lord, and said, Thou art my God. My times are in thy hand. Deliver me from the hand of mine oppressors and from them that persecute me. Psalm 31, verses 14 through 15. Christian Michael Sams. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. Raina K. Schwant. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Jeremiah 29, verse 11. Lance Daniel Stevens. Commit thy works unto the Lord, and thy thoughts shall be established. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 3. Hannah Shelley Strickland. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such things there is no law. Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. Mekius William Thompson. I have fought the good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. Victoria Amina Walker. For God hath not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. At this time, having now received their diplomas and in keeping with a long-held Conway Christian School tradition, the graduates will now turn and honor one another by the moving of each other's tassels, signifying publicly their accomplishments as a class. Ms. Smith, Mrs. Hogue, Conway Christian School Board of Directors, administration, teachers and staff, family and friends, join me in congratulations as I now have the high privilege and personal honor of presenting to you the Conway Christian School graduating class of 2022. Graduates, you may be seated. As Mrs. Hurley comes up, and just as a personal note again, I am grateful that we are able to be here with you this evening and share in your triumph and to share in your accomplishments. And just from a personal note from My wife and I, in our 15 years of marriage and ministry together, this song I think is very fitting for you as graduates and as family, and I hope that it blesses the Lord first and foremost, but also that it will bless you and that it will remind you of who holds you in this life. So I might pray this will encourage you as we continue our service tonight.
Will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold on life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. Christ will hold me fast. Precious in his holy sight, he will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last. But by him at such a cost, he will hold me. With him to endless life.
love you guys.
Graduates, before I get to tell everyone about all of your exciting plans for the future, I also have the privilege of reading a letter that we received in your honor. Dear graduates, it is with great pleasure that I send congratulations to the Conway Christian School class of 2022. Your graduation marks a major milestone in your lives. Through your hard work and dedication to learning, each of you has established a foundation that will serve you well as you face the challenges of the future. As you begin the next exciting chapter of your life, it is my hope that you will continue to strive for excellence in all that you do and make the most of every opportunity that arises. Peggy and I are pleased to send our congratulations, and we wish you the best in future endeavors. Yours very truly, Henry McMaster, South Carolina Governor. The class of 2022 has lived a unique high school story for a unique class. We've taught you math, English, science, and the Word of God. But you have taught us things too. You have lived history, and you have made history. You've made history with the first SCISA student government statewide officer, not once but twice. You've made history as the first football scholarship athlete, full scholarship athlete, from Conway Christian School. You've made history as the first second-generation Conway Christian School graduate and the first to be awarded the Most Outstanding Senior Award by the Conway Chamber of Commerce for the entire county. You've also made history by collectively dressing as a den of beavers, teaching me dance moves that I didn't want to know. And this is the first time that I have ever sent five graduates away out of town to the same college in the time that I've been a guidance counselor, to spend four more years together, either because you love each other very much or because you know that Lance needs four mamas in the absence of Miss Tiffany. We've spent countless hours together discussing life and goals and the future, as well as random other topics that you use to distract me from teaching. Today, you walk across the stage with a diploma that represents academics, leadership, community service, Christian character, and a whole lot of fun memories. I'm so excited to send you out onto the individual paths that set before you, knowing that you are fully prepared to take on the world for Christ. Each of our graduates has met the qualifications for South Carolina scholarships awarded to high school graduates demonstrating excellence in academics and attending a public or private college or university in the state of South Carolina. The qualifications and awards for these scholarships are as follows. The HOPE Scholarship, also called the Life Scholarship for two-year colleges, is awarded to graduates earning a cumulative 3.0 GPA on the South Carolina Uniform Grading Scale, which all of our graduates have done this year. Recipients maintaining a 3.0 GPA and 30 credit hours during their first year of study then qualify for the Life Scholarship at four-year institutions. The Life Scholarship for four-year colleges is awarded immediately to graduates completing two of the following requirements: a cumulative 3.0 GPA based on the South Carolina Uniform Grading Scale, a score of at least 1,100 on the SAT or 24 on the ACT, or a rank in the top 30% of their graduating class. Tonight, it is my pleasure to share with you the future plans, scholarships, college acceptances, and other recognitions earned by the Conway Christian School class of 2021. Landon Allen has met the requirements for the South Carolina Life for two-year college scholarship. He will attend Horry Georgetown Technical College to study machine tool technology. Josiah Crawford has met the requirements for the South Carolina Life scholarship. He received the Most Outstanding Senior Countywide Scholarship Award presented by the Conway Chamber of Commerce. He will attend Bob Jones University with a BJU First From Scholarship to prepare for a career in dentistry. Caroline Dill has met the requirements for the South Carolina Life Scholarship. She will attend Coker University, where she has received the Trustee Scholarship and the Ruth Lawton Wild Scholarship for Music and will study opera. Cortland Hardwick has met the requirements for the South Carolina Hope Scholarship. She received the Cutlass Scholarship, Palmetto Girls State Scholarship, and Student Leadership Scholarship to attend Charleston Southern University pursuing studies in criminal justice. Laura Hewitt has met the requirements for the South Carolina Hope Scholarship. She received the Veterans of Foreign Wars Scholarship and the Student Leadership University Scholarship at Charleston Southern, where she'll pursue a degree in public health, followed by a master's degree at MUSC to become a speech pathologist. Emily Lucius has met the requirements for the South Carolina Life Scholarship. She has received the President's Scholarship to attend North Greenville University to study business administration. DeAndre Only has met the requirements for the South Carolina Hope Scholarship. He has been awarded a full athletic scholarship to play football and will major in communications and media at Newberry University. Madison Pegram has met the requirements for South Carolina Life Scholarship. She was awarded the Santee Cooper Employees Children's Scholarship. She has been awarded the Jerry C. Hunter Scholarship and the Student Leadership University Conference Scholarship to Charleston Southern University, where she will pursue a pre-medical degree and then attend medical school to become a neonatal surgeon. Christian Sams has met the requirements for the South Carolina Life Scholarship for two-year colleges. He plans to attend Ori Georgetown Technical College to pursue a career as a machine tool operator. Raina Schwant has met the requirements for the South Carolina Hope Scholarship. She will attend Charleston Southern University with the Jerry C. Hunter and Student Leadership Scholarships to pursue a career in the medical field. Lance Stevens has met the requirements for the South Carolina Life Scholarship. He will receive the Cutlass Scholarship, the Boys State Scholarship, the Jerry C. Hunter Scholarship, and the Student Leadership Conference Scholarship to attend Charleston Southern University for pre-law studies before attending law school. Hannah Strickland has met the requirements for the South Carolina Life for two-year colleges award. She will begin her nursing studies at Ori Georgetown Technical College with the goal of completing both her RN and BSN and possibly becoming a nurse practitioner or physician's assistant. Mekias Thompson has met the requirements for the South Carolina Life Scholarship for two-year colleges. He will attend Ori Georgetown Technical College to study diesel mechanics. Victoria Walker has met the requirements for the South Carolina Life Scholarship. She will attend the University of South Carolina to study finance and accounting. Class of 2022, you know I love you all, and I can't wait to see God's plans unfold in your lives. Be bold, stay awesome, and make good choices.
Good evening, parents, friends, students, faculty, special guests, and members of the board. My name is Lance Stevens, and as a proud member of the SCISA statewide student government, former student body president, and proud member of the class of 2022, it is my pleasure and honor to present to the school the class of 2022's senior gift. I know I speak for all of us when I say we can never fully give back all that we've been given during our years at Conway Christian School. Whether it was after school tutoring, a loving hug when you needed it, or making sure we never went hungry, we will never be able to thank the teachers and the staff of the school enough. We would like to show our utmost appreciation for all the spiritual, academic, and life lessons we have learned in our time by presenting the school with a new eagle mural for the school gym. This mural will help serve as a reminder of the class of 2022 when students walk through the halls, participate in sporting events, and come for other school functions. Acts 20:35 says, "In everything I did, I showed you by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak." Remembering the words of Jesus himself saying, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." Words or actions will never be able to say thank you enough to the faculty and staff, but we hope this gift will remind you of our appreciation every day. Once an eagle, always an eagle. Thank you.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we just come before you tonight, Lord. praising your name, Lord, and thanking you for all you have done for us, Lord. We ask now that you would be with these graduates, Lord, as they take the next step in life, that in everything they do, Lord, they will seek your guidance and your will. Lord, we thank you for the privilege of being a part of their lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you.